Okay, hello everyone. Thank you for joining this online public discussion organized by Cemeti Institute for Art and Society in the framework of Toko Buku Liong Art Project. My name is Manshur Zikri, Artistic Manager at Cemeti, is hosting you and become the moderator in this discussion. Toko Buku Liong is a collaborative art project by Adelina Luft, a curator from Romania who is currently based in Yogyakarta, and Daniel Lee, a Brazilian Indonesian artist. And changing from its initial planning, which was originally intended as a physical exhibition, this project was built in online format and web hosted by Cemeti since 4th of August until 4th of September 2020. You can check on the project on at the link www.tokobukuliong.com, in which all the artworks archived as well as the text and images of the research and interpretation are curated and presented in the form of virtually accessible contents. And according to its description, as posted on the website, it is an effort to recollect the biographical fragments of the Lee family and the comics they produced and published at Toko Buku Liong in the 1950s by creating an effective archive situated at the intersection with the identity politics, power structure, and cultural agency in post-independence Indonesia. So it is not only a tactical way to dealing with the current circumstances of the pandemic, but it is also an alternative way to experiment with hybridizing form of visual expression, as well as to create transnational and multilingual accessibility. In Cemeti, by our perspective as an art institution and space, this project is very important because Toko Buku Liong's online presentation itself is in line with the main agenda, which is currently being carried out at Cemeti. That is how to develop effective methods for rereading as well as presenting new interpretation of art archive in the context of curatorial practices. And the approach taken by Adelina Luft and Daniel Lee to the Toko Buku Liong history indirectly represents such a spirit of curating best work, both in terms of aesthetic speculation as well as in its practical and technical qualities. This is an artist talk session, one part of the four virtual discussions which are held to support the discourse of production concerning Toko Buku Liong, Indonesian comics and comics artists, and comics publisher. Right now, the two speakers are here with us, Adelina Luft and Daniel Lee. And for about 2 hours, we are going to listen to their talks, which are expected to be quite comprehensive on the background of the ideas, process, and experimentation of the research and production methods of Toko Buku Liong. We are gonna take some Q&A also after their talk, and the audience can also give comments and ask questions via chat column, I think, so that our team will collect those questions and we will read them after Adelina and Daniel presentation. Just to remind that this online discussion will be recorded by Cemeti's team, and we plan to edit these recordings and we'll post it on Cemeti's YouTube channel so that netizens can access it anytime they want. Well, now I would like to ask and welcome Adelina and Daniel to tell you about the project, especially the things that related to their artistic approach, process, and collaborative idea, as well as the background that led to the initiation of the art project Toko Buku Liong. So please, Daniel and Adele.
Thank you very much, Zikri, for the introduction. I'm Adelina and I'm here with Daniel. First, I would like to start by thanking to Cemeti team for helping us in hosting and organizing this project, particularly to Zikri, who is also hosting this talk. Zikri has helped us a lot in creating the web platform. With his amazing skills, we had the possibility to create a very quick and interesting display of the volumes and the works. Also thanks to Izul with the long name Muhammad Zulkarnain, I hope I'm saying it right, for creating the visual identity of this project, for presenting it on the Cemeti platform, and also for helping us in designing some of the timelines and some of the visual presentations in each volume. Also, thanks to Linda for organizing this project, for giving us great resources in our research process. To Ika Nurcahyani for the translations to Bahasa Indonesia, because myself and Daniel, we are non-native English speakers. We also had an editor for the English language by Ellen Lee, a friend from Kuala Lumpur. And we have a long list of thank you notes for many people who have helped us in this project, which we placed in the website on the credits page. We have credited people for each chapter related to the resources we received, the materials, the archives, particularly to Daniel's family, who have helped us greatly in assembling the materials, the archives of the family. And this is the short thank you list that we wanted to share. And now I would like to give you a brief introduction of how myself and Daniel, we have met. It was actually in 2017. I was helping Pius Gid Kunchoro, the curator for the fourth edition of Biennale Jogja Equator. At the time, the Biennale was in a conversation with Brazil, because each edition moves towards around the equator belt. And that edition, I was in charge of the Brazilian artists who organized their works and also the residency of some of the artists who arrived in Jogja. And that is when I met Daniel. Daniel came here in a residency for a month. And that is when I got to know a little bit about the family background. When Daniel visited Semarang briefly. But then I was very excited to know that Daniel is coming back last year. And so I immediately approached Daniel to collaborate. Just a short disclaimer, I would like to mention that Daniel is non-binary and I might refer to Daniel as them. But if I make any mistake in telling he, I apologize, but I have acknowledged that from the beginning. So maybe I will let Daniel to also talk a little bit about coming back to Indonesia last year and what was your intention initially.
Selamat malam, good evening, everybody, or good morning if there's anybody in other countries. Thank you so much for your time and for being here. Thank you so much for your attention towards this project as well. The first time I was here and I came to Indonesia was in 2017. And then it was the first time I was able to come to this far and distance, but yet very present country in my life. Me being a son, a child, a daughter from Indonesian family, I have been growing with very close and very connected information about Indonesia, but also because the migration of people from Indonesia, it's very little. And we as a family, we didn't have any other narratives or the people from Indonesia that we could share our experiences. It was very important for me to come to Indonesia and know more about this place that I'm also from and connected to. So in 2017 was the first approach, but it was only 2 months. And that was like very small and very, very little to understand the diversity, the immenseness of the culture here. Right then, I understood I needed to spend more time. And as I left Indonesia, I also started to understand through articles that what my family has done here was beyond what we as the survivors from the family, as the people who are still living, we knew the dimension of what my grandparents did. And there were a lot to know, much more to figure out. So I instantly knew that I needed to spend a longer time. A year and a half later, 2 years later, I was able to return to Indonesia, this time to live, to stay for a year with the intention to understand more about the culture, to learn the language, to understand more about my family's story and how, and about also politics as well.
Thank you. So we met again in 2019 around October, and I approached Daniel because some of my curatorial and research interests revolve around identity politics or politics of representation. I also reflect on the history of communism in Indonesia, But in a sort of compare and contrast way with the history of communism in my own country, in Romania. And somehow these backgrounds have kind of led me to explore this part of history in Indonesia of the 50s that I think it's particularly interesting and complex. Also I am interested in collaborating with artists and exploring possibilities of collaboration, of working together in finding and looking for possibilities of art making and researching as well. So this project started with these initial thoughts. And since then we have moved along the year and beginning of 2020 with lots of conversations about what we can do, how we can work together. And that's when I approached Cemeti to host an exhibition that we initially thought could be interesting. And so we have already developed some ideas of how to bring this complex and different aspects of the story into a physical form in the gallery space. But also thinking at the same time that this could later on turn into a research paper or into an academic paper. However, I myself am interested to explore besides academia, how we can narrate and how we can present this short and brief and complex research. I think it was around March or April that we started to rethink the project into an online format because of the pandemic. And also as we were conversating and thinking about the platform, we realized that this is actually a more suitable way of presenting the project because our thoughts and research was already divided into particular aspects related to the story, about the identity of the family, about the comic productions, about Wiro, the Jungle Boy, the legacy comic of Toko Buku Liong and its founders as the authors of this comic. So there were several aspects that we thought could be more interestingly narrated into a sequential reading and borrowing from comic productions of volumes, so jilid in Bahasa Indonesia. So Wiro, for instance, was published in 10 volumes, 10 jilid. And we thought that we could borrow from this type of presentation of publishing, but doing it in the online and also explore aspects of presentation with artworks, with texts, and also with videos, photos, and so on. Do you want to add something?
Yeah, initially also when Adelina approached me, what we've been doing, I think, is very, very new for my practice and also for Madelina. Something that she has been doing is very new. It's very important that we also say that this project, for a long time, we were figuring out what would our roles be named, because this is very different from a traditional artist and creator relationship. Once we are both thinking about the content, creative content, this is very much 50-50. And once we had Cemeti institutions together, then this work started to divide even more. And right in the beginning, I was like, well, the reason why I came to Indonesia was precisely to understand more. And then with working together with Adelina, it's very important to have a different point of view towards story, access to information. Me, myself, because when I arrived in Indonesia, I did not know how to speak the language at all as well. So at the same time, even though what I've been doing in my practice, I've been working with installations, the creation of spaces. In the past, I also have been bringing some stories of the family, but not as focused and not as profound as in this project. It has been making sense, but at the same time, it was the perfect situation as well. Because at the end, now that we're presenting this project, I realized, well, I came here to do this. And I wouldn't be able to do this by myself because then it would be so intimate. I would be so much together within the stories of the family. It would be so much about an inner story. And this is not our only goal here. We're interested to look the relationship between the small part with the bigger parts, the micro and the macro, and how can this story of this family be also read in a very more generous, more bigger sense. So again, this position, which is very important for this project, as we mentioned before, how it's important to make a archive which has emotions, an archive that is living, an archive that has affection. So in this sense, I think this both positions are very important, because sometimes it's too emotive for me. And then I needed the point of view from Adelina, which is more further away. Or sometimes the archives information that we were getting, they were very cold, because that's in my reading, sometimes we relate with archives and with history in a very cold manner without emotions. And then sometimes I would need to come and say, wait, what about this, you know? So again, just bringing the fact that if you listen to what you say, if you look at this project, have in mind that everything has been done in partnership.
And related to the process and the fact that we changed or initiated this web-hosted platform, a lot of the materials and the personal archives of Lee family arrived gradually throughout this year. Well, we didn't have them from the beginning, so it was an interesting way of how we were trying to assemble them and place them in each volume. And also, one important thing to mention is that I hope to have a little bit more time to prepare this project, but I think because Daniel is living here until this year only, I thought that this is a good opportunity now to execute it and to present it in this format that is also trying to be more inclusive. And through translations, we also try to create more accessibility, especially for Daniel's family who don't necessarily understand English or Bahasa Indonesia. So our target or our audiences are quite wide. They span from Indonesia also to Brazil, and using English as a way to connect also with more people and our language that we use more easily than Bahasa or Portuguese, of course, Daniel's language, native language. So Daniel has been working also a lot to translate all the text on the website to Portuguese. And this platform, as Zikri also mentioned during the introduction, is also as a way for us to experiment with this hybrid forms of art making and researching, and also to look at their intersection. So the way we see it is both as a space of exhibiting our work, but also as a form of like publication. And also we see it as an artwork itself that ends on the fourth volume. And so it can be further presented in other projects or expanded perhaps in a physical form later on. So it has multiple ways of looking at it, and also possibilities of exploring it further into a physical, or even exploring it in the online with contributions from other people. And one other aspect is that we always mention is this platform as opening a conversation with more people that have more thorough research into these topics related to Chinese, Indonesian minorities, related to artists or comic contributions from Chinese, Indonesians of Chinese descent. But also how comic productions in the 50s have also been part of that search for a cultural and national identity. This is how we assembled this project and try to reflect on these biographical fragments. And of course, it is a very in-depth and personal story that we hope can also be a reflection for other such people or topics related with comic contributions or with the period of the 50s. And what I tried to do was also to situate this biographical fragments within the sociopolitical context of the time. And when we will go through each volume, we can explain more about how we did that, and we can expand more the talk about each volume, what we presented, and also what challenges we faced and things that perhaps are not yet visible in the platform. Maybe we can, you want to add something or?
Yeah, just like briefly going through, sometimes like when people think about comics nowadays and why are we choosing in the 50s, I read that in the 50s comic books was just like Instagram nowadays or the TV shows, and how that pop culture, they would influence in the subjectivity on the people's desire, the people's images they're creating. The same way that we watch movies and TV series and we see Instagram nowadays, that was the comic books in the 50s. And also for people who are not from aware of Indonesian story, it's why we also chose this period of time, not only because it was the time that my family migrated. My family, my grandparents, they were authors and the creators of the name of our project, Toko Buku Liong, the Liong bookstore. And they made one of the most famous and renowned comic books of Indonesia that impacted till nowadays the culture. And I only figured out about that when I was 29 years old. I didn't grow up knowing that. And also for people who are not aware from Indonesian stories, in the mid-40s, Indonesia got independent from the colony of Dutch, and then started to become Indonesia as name, as also as nation, and needed to shape the identity, needed to shape the culture. So this time was a period of change. It was also post-war. It was also between the war between capitalism and communism. So a lot of things were changing, and this period of time, I think they're quite interesting. So just a disclaimer for people who do not know, and how also these comic books, they play a strong role influencing the creation of identity, influencing the creation of the culture's culture, the country culture. Sorry, yeah.
Thank you for the disclaimer. Actually, I plan to talk a little bit more about it in the when we look at the first volume, okay, because that talks more about the context of the 50s in a way. But just to mention quickly, I think this research for me opened up these gaps in the history of comics and also in the history of the 50s in Indonesia that I think are very important to address, mainly because, related to how popular culture, that is comics as well, have been a contribution in that dynamics and search for a national cultural identity that Daniel also mentioned, and also how the subjectivities of the authors of these comics have played a role in that search. And for me, what was new was researching about Chinese Indonesians. I think I dedicated relatively short time for this research, but I think the speaker that will present more tomorrow, Brigitta Isabella, has already started that very important research contribution of how Chinese Indonesian artists have played a role in that complex period of the 50s. And so I hope to open up a further conversation about how comic artists of Chinese descent, or in general comic artists in the 50s, have played that role in that search. So this is the short version. So maybe we can share the screen,
yep,
and go through each volume.
Yep.
Yeah, you just can share your screen, Adam.
Yes, we are doing it now.
So here we have our beautiful presentation. Just to go through, this is this dragon of Toko Buku Liong is one of the logos that we found it in the archives. And for people who do not know, Liong means the dance of the dragon, or the dancing dragon.
The dance of the dragon.
The dance of the dragon. And just also, I'm going to start saying this. The names of my grandparents is Lee Jong Nin and Ong Kim Neo. And they mixed their names, Lee and Ong, and made the word Liong. So that's also tells a lot about this mixture of names, this 50-50, how they were working as well. So we're going to start now with our first volume, Jilid Satu, which we call Escombros.
So So we chose this name from Portuguese language. It's an imperfect translation of ruins or puing-puing in Bahasa Indonesia. And it started with our visit in Semarang, which we had done in January this year. We visited to find out where actually Toko Buku Liong was placed, because from Daniel's previous visit in 2017, it wasn't very clear where it was, because Daniel was navigating through the memories of the family, which were trying to guide Daniel around the city to find out where it was. But yep, it wasn't that place that was mm-hmm. initially thought, which was so interesting of how when coming back, we mm-hmm. found out where it was. And so I actually just looked at the comic archive in which was mentioned Purwodinatan number 27. So we tried to look at that street and number, and it appeared to be in front of Blenduk Church in Kota Lama. And now it's Jalan Legend Suprapto, still number 27. And before it was, during the colonial occupation, it was, I think, Hermannstrasse or something like that. And so when we arrived in this place, we noticed that it's a very interesting... maybe we can look at the video.
Yeah, it was an opening.
It was a building that was still in sort of a ruin. It was illegally constructed in around 1997. The owner of this building has escaped somehow. It's impossible to find him. We know this from some people that we have interviewed, especially with people from the tourism industry that are now working to revive this Kota Lama. And it's interesting that it's the only building in Kota Lama that has this very suspended entity. It's a suspended building.
This one.
It's supposed to be like a modern construction among all these colonial architectures that are kept as a heritage in Kota Lama. And we thought that this building, when we thought about the exhibition, we were thinking that this is an interesting way to approach the framing of and the narrative of the installation that we wanted to propose at Cemeti at the time. We thought that from these material ruins and also the immaterial ruins of the Lee family are related to how these biographical fragments are somehow incomplete and unknown, mainly because the family hasn't shared all the history of their time in Indonesia. So it's kind of stopped when they migrated in 1958. So through this allegory of, you know, how this ruined and escombros, the ruins of the material ruins and immaterial ruins of this story, has kind of led us into thinking more poetically about this first volume. And during the pandemic, I was forced in a way to work only with archive materials, although the initial idea was to create a more complex video that talks about the whole aspect of this story. But because I only had certain archives to work with, then I approached this video as a prologue to the story of Toko Buku Liong. But this whole volume is more focused on how the period of... on how the space actually looked like, or trying to find how it looked like, and also to set the context of Toko Buku Liong as being a bookstore active in the 50s. So for those who don't understand Bahasa Indonesia, Toko Buku, it means bookstore. And so for us, it was interesting to reflect on how this Toko Buku Liong was placed in this complex and of time of Indonesia, when cultural mobility and these ideological conflicts were taking place, but also how the Cold War politics were playing its role in how the common urban middle class would consume culture. This is how we reflect on the production also of Toko Buku Liong, of having these various influences from American culture, US culture, through Western comics, and also the fact that they also published Chinese folk tales and myths in Bahasa Indonesia. So Bahasa Indonesia played also a very important role during that time in the 50s. And all publications of this place were written in Bahasa. There were no Chinese language written, and the books they were selling were imported from Dutch. And some of the interviewees we had in Semarang, like John Kitio, he's a storyteller and restaurant owner who published a book about the riwayat, the history of Kota Lama, through his own personal photographs he took during the time, and through his memories we could access to know what was going on with Toko Buku Liong and why they left. He remembers going there and reading Dutch books and Dutch comics, but also he remembers reading Wiro, Anak Rimba Indonesia, and he mentioned it was a very very famous place, as positioned in, I think, kilometer zero of Kota Lama,
the old city
of Semarang. And he, through his memories, would also know that there was rumors about the presidential regulation. Are we blocked?
No.
Presidential regulation number 59. That was released in 1959, but apparently in 58 there were already like rumors about its implementation for sending home the Chinese Indonesian who were trading in the rural areas, Kabupaten in Bahasa. And so it was very interesting to hear about the story of how they got panicked in a way about this this regulation, but we can talk more about it in the second volume when we talk about the family. So related to this chapter, the video collages that you saw in the video are actually memories of Daniel's Lee's father and aunts about how Toko Buku Liong looked like,
especially the aunts,
because the first daughter was 12 years old when they migrated. And Daniel's father was only 2 years old. But unfortunately, from the archive institution in Semarang, we couldn't find any image of Toko Buku Liong during the 50s. We only have one image that we haven't shared yet. From 1994, when Daniel's grandfather, Lee John Lim, he returned to Indonesia to visit, and he took a photo of the place, which at that time was already a restaurant, but the foundation of the place was still keeping the same structure of Toko Buku Liong. So we assume that it was demolished during the 90s, 97, when this person that now has constructed this illegally building. So for 20 years, this building is still in that shape in Kota Lama. This metaphor of this building for us was also a way to question our failure to remember. And through this video, I approach this idea of the inevitability of forgetting, of how this period and their identity and the fact that they were cultural producers of comics is an inevitable process of forgetting because of their marginalization, and also because popular culture was not is not yet researched by historians. So then these layers of marginalization have, I think, been somehow inevitable, and we try to reconstruct and assemble these to bring them to the fore and to also invite other researchers to perhaps explore these topics together.
My relationship with this from the start, it was quite difficult because to migrate to Brazil was very traumatic. My family went through many social changes, and I can only imagine when you go through so much changes in every aspect of your life, there's a lot of things you do not want to remember. My grandparents, they passed away. Onkin Neo passed away, my grandmother, in 84, so that was like 4 years before I was born. And Lee Jong Lee passed away when he was in 2001 at 85, when I was 13 years old. So I was a teenager. I didn't have yet the desire to fully understand, or the possibility to understand where was I. If you cannot listen to me, just give me a holler, okay? Again, in the end of the Biennale, when I saw this information that what my grandparents did was renowned for the country as a culture, that was shocking because I only thought they were very independent and they were doing things very small for the neighborhood, maybe, you know, and very not professional, actually. And later, also, there was another issue which the journalist referred to my grandfather as Chinese. In this sense, for me, because I'm Brazilian, the way we construct identity is very, politically, is very different from Indonesia. I was like, wait. My family is Indonesian, we're not Chinese. I know that we have Chinese descendant, but we always identify ourselves as Indonesians. Which is something that only now living in Indonesia, knowing more the complexity, historical complexity about shaping this identity, I can understand better the differences of it. But this is very important to say that wherever you go, the understanding of identity is going to be very different from each country to country, because that's politics. For also this project, when I also went to Kota Lama, I saw that structure. It was very paradoxical and quite ironic that this whole neighborhood, which is trying to make a huge effort to keep and the memory of the 50s, of even before, of this old neighborhood, this heritage neighborhood, the only place that we were really looking forward and has this more modern contemporary structure, like these metal structures, it was where the library was. So, and it's very hard to find information about this place. So that again goes with this thing about forgetting, and also how the archives that we had, Adelina's research, lots of them were not very precise about the information regarding the productions of the comic books in Toko Buku Liong. At the same time, it was very hard for me from my family to get those information, because the majority of the children from Lee Jong Lee and Onkin Neo, they arrived in Brazil when they were child. So like my father, for instance, all his memories are from Brazil. So how was I able to know about Indonesia, the culture, the complexities, from the only people who I was able to have the contact about is they did not remember about Indonesia, or they knew very little about it. There was no other immigrants. So to find identity was very hard. This installation and this performance piece, La Portal, this was a way that in my works they're very important, so I do offerings, I do treat them as a respect, as rituals. So this I assemble with incense sticks in their semarang, and then in this act of putting fire on them, it's also a way to send this message in other forms, not only through words, not only through the website, but also in a very symbolical and poetical way, I must say. No. I think maybe we can go to Jilid Dua. So here we have our second volume, Strangers Who Are Not Foreign. Strangers Who Are Not Foreign is a title from a book that I think Adele can talk briefly about it. This, I'm going to go through quickly what it is. I think this volume is the one who has more content about it, because Then the first one, it's an introduction. It's about the landscape, where we are, where this narrative is being situated. The second chapter, we're introducing the characters, the Lee family. Who were they? What were they doing? What they went through? What was going on at the time, politically wise? Here we have four contents. The introduction written by Adele, Record of Estrangement, which is Adele research with the political facts that was going on at the time. The Decades Between the 2nd and 21st of January, which is an interview with the daughter of Ong Kim-Niu and Lee Jong-Lee, my aunt Yanni, who passed away while we were doing this research. So this is also very interesting. How, for me, the most important thing is and looking for the archive, when we have the living archive, the people who remember and their memories. I was very lucky to start to do this search for identity 4 or 5 years ago, and then I interviewed one of my aunts, and I asked her to talk about the family, the migration, and about her life. And in this chapter, we have her interview talking about all of this. And also we have her photos of her memory. She was the oldest daughter, so she also had to take the role as a parent towards her siblings. So here we have the living. Then I have a text that I'm talking about a very subjective perspective, how I'm talking about meeting this grandmother I never met, and how we navigate through time, and how I came to live in Indonesia 60 years afterwards they migrated to Brazil, and how in this sense of coming and going and not going through the obvious and traveling through time, we start to find information about our memories, and we start to understand what is existence, what is to be alive, how to connect with life, actually. But I must say, on a personal perspective, that because for me it was very hard to get information, and every time I got information, I was also reacting in an emotional level. So every time I knew about something very strong that happened politically in the government, I thought, like, how were my grandparents reacting to this in a psychological level, in an emotional level? How was this affecting their relationships? How was this affecting everything, you know? So through Adele's research, that Adele's pinpoints many political facts that were going on since they were born to their migration a little bit afterwards, this was like, okay, this is a lot, because it stopped being this narrative from the family, oh, we migrated, and then it started to get politically complex, and then we start to understand the roots of the complexity of the building of identity, or the exclusion of some people who were also part of the construction of this country. You know, my grandparents were not migrators from China. They've been many, many, many generations. And my question is, like, why you still keep calling us Chinese, and why you keep seeing us as foreigners when we've been here in this place for many, many generations, and we've been mixing with people who have been natives? And maybe their identity was out of time, you know? I see now who they were in the 50s, very close to what people are in Indonesia nowadays. Please, Adele. I think now in this introduction, Adele is the best one to approach.
Really. I think this is the kind of the strength of the volumes. It's the most dense and the most dense chapter. Strangers were not foreign. It's actually part of. It's a quote from Pramudya Nantatower, who wrote a series of articles in. Bintang Minggu during the 59 to counter this presidential regulation that was implicitly or directly affecting the Lee family. And I thought it's an interesting way of framing this chapter through Pramudya's view on how this Chinese Indonesians are part of the nation, and excluding them or estranging them is estranging the actual national identity itself. And I have written in this introduction a lot about the identity of the Lee family, who they were, the fact that they have been, their family has been here for a couple of generations, and also how I see this identity of Chinese Indonesian as hyphenated, and how the power structures and the system of values in Indonesia have kind of played a choreography on estranging and hyphenating their identity through from the colonial time until perhaps the present. But I'm more focusing on the period when Lee family was here and how we can look through this hyphenation for how we can look at their identity. I just touched briefly how what kind of culture they were consuming, the fact that I think it's important to put out the facts about their given identity and their affiliation, although they perhaps didn't feel as Chinese in this context, but just to give this intersectional reading about who they were and not just claiming they were marginalized or discriminated within this context. But for myself, I only have approached this in a very short time, and I think the discussion tomorrow with Brigitta Isabella can give us a much more in-depth view on ways of researching and the methodology that is perhaps more appropriate to use when talking about the ethnic of Chinese minority in Indonesia. For me, it was important to put out the information that we have received from the family so that we can think by ourselves of how they were navigating around the political context of the time. And this timeline that I compiled, which I can't access because how to...
Tunggu sebentar. Okay.
So this unfinished and incomplete timeline is trying to situate the family since Lee Junlin was born in Kudus in 1916 until their migration in 1958. So I have read several resources, but mainly I took information from Leo Suryadinata's books that I could access from home. I have compiled this as a way to speculate on the potential causes or the gradual forms of estrangement that have taken place in this family to finally decide to migrate to Brazil and to look for a better future, as Lee Junlin has often mentioned that he's looking for a better future for his children. So this is, of course, we take, for instance, John Kitio's assessment and memories as one part of the many aspects that have contributed to their decision to migrate, but I don't point to one aspect or the other. I don't know, for instance, if Peraturan Pemerintah or the presidential regulation has actually had such an impact on them to decide on leaving. So we are just compiling this and assembling. I think this chapter is also the strength of the project because we are trying to address this idea of affective archives. And this is the chapter volume where we more particularly focus on or finding ways of how to archive these emotions and feelings, these affectivities. Because the archive field has often been concerned and preoccupied with the actual and the tangible. And we think that in this sense, there are some questions that we are still addressing. It's not something that we have formulated as such, but we question like how we can archive such personal and emotional stories, and also if they can an alternative to addressing this history of marginalized groups. And Another question would be, what theoretical concepts and models might be challenged by explicitly incorporating affective considerations? But also, it's another way to challenge ways of researching, ways of archiving, and perhaps also to challenge historiography. And this is more for the second chapter. Do you want to add something?
Yeah, before we go to the third one, just to add what Adele said and to conclude. So for instance, when we talk about emotional archive, and then everything we look at, my family or the country stories or whatever stories that we see as facts. This happened and then this happened and then this happens. But there are many things that cause things to change. And it's also because we're humans, it's also triggered by emotions, feelings. So there was a moment that I imagine that my grandparents, they were feeling many uncertainties, they were feeling many complexities, and then bottom line, they felt insecure about Indonesia. And then this insecureness made them feel, and then the feeling made them go through a decision, and that decision was, we need to migrate. We don't know, we cannot pinpoint why they migrate. I can say that if you are certain of everything, you're not gonna move. No, they were rich, they had a good business, they were famous, they had 9 children. My grandmother, she was an autonomous, progressive woman in the 50s in Indonesia, you know? And then you suddenly move and then you lose everything. You know, they were filled of uncertainties. If you have everything certain, you're not gonna move. Everything's good. You're gonna move when things start to be messed up. And I also talk that from my experience. And just to resume this volume, if in the first one we were talking about escombros, and the word escombros means ruins, it also comes a lot of from a personal perspective, that what I had from my story in Brazil, where they started when they lost everything. So in Brazil, they became poor. In Brazil, the family relationships, they were completely shattered. They were isolated culturally. They were treated with a lot of racism. They changed social class to rich to extremely poor. So they lost, and that was destroyed. And what it was left were ruins, and they needed to build themselves from the ruins. And that's what I talk in one of the texts. The ruins are my home. And in this one, the investigation is, okay, if there is a ruins, one day there was something before there. There was a building, there was a structure, something like this. The second chapter, we're talking about this. And when we look at identity-wise, that's also when it gets complicated, because my grandparents, they were born before Indonesia was Indonesia. They were born in the Dutch colonies. So their education needed to be a Dutch education, so they knew how to speak Dutch. And maybe that was also influenced after the post-war, their wish and desire for the Western world. They were dressing as Westerns. They had Chinese name. They went through the independence of Indonesia, so then they became Indonesians. And also now that I'm living here for a year, I start to realize they actually are Japanese. They spoke Japanese as well, but the way they act life, the way they have their habits and culture, it was Japanese. And then they move to Brazil, and then they need to figure out a new identity. They lose memory about Indonesia. So we're talking about a very complex identity that many times it's lost identity, you know? So then if we were in the first, we presented the place, the second one, we're presenting the characters. In the third one, we're talking about what they were doing. So let's begin with the third one and then Adele's gonna take the floor. Is it sharing? Yeah.
Just to add on what you just mentioned, I think one aspect is also talking about the locality in which they were active. As Semarang, for many people who don't know, maybe from abroad, it's a port city that has been a Dutch occupation for a very long time. And in this context, the Lee family perhaps makes more sense why they have been educated in Dutch schools and have been using Dutch as a currency to negotiate and to navigate and create their business at the time. So this locality is also important because Semarang is a city that keeps, like in the 50s, was still perhaps run by this Dutch businessman and also Chinese, played an important role in the shaping of their identity. So the third chapter, the volume we are going into, the production that was released by Toko Buku Liong. But maybe I can start first about the comics, just to relate to the previous volume. Again, we think that the production of Toko Buku Liong is a reflection of their hybrid identity in the history of comics in Indonesia. It also reflects not just the hybrid identity, but this heterogeneous body of work, and also the cultural dynamics of the time, which I briefly mentioned, how, let's say, the US culture has played a role in how they had access in importing books from Europe and also from US. At the time, Medan, another city, was very important in this border between the West and Indonesia, of how lots of comics were going through Medan first and then spreading in Java. So I think that the access they had with their ability perhaps to import cultural books and comics played a role in how they imagined their own productions that they published. So Toko Buku Liong mainly produced Chinese classics. So they had divided their publication into Chinese classics and also for Nyonya Nyonya, so for ladies, and also for entertainment. Some of the entertainment comics were Dagelan, Petruk, and Gareng. And from my research, I have found out that Petruk and Gareng, as the Punakawan characters, were the first one that were brought in comics by Toko Buku Liong, and afterward it became a subgenre in comics. And they have collaborated with Indris Dono, the artist of this comic that afterwards have become quite popular in the comics produced in Indonesia. And also they have published a book like in, I think, 8 volumes, Si Jin Kui, which was a comic that initially was published by Xiao Tikui, an artist of Chinese descent, who published it in a newspaper. So it was as a comic strip. But Toko Buku Liong was the first one to publish it in volumes. And it was, again, a collaboration between an artist, an illustrator, and a writer. And Betong Lin, for instance, we know nothing about this artist, but Kam Sen Kyu was a sort of a writer and intellectual of that time, and he has also published another book about Chinese culture with Toko Buku Liong as well. So besides comics, there were also books published. And CU is another comic that we can see it had this collective way of drawing. So they don't use the authorship of only one artist. It's made in a collective way, which in Bahasa would be keroyokan, which I found as the term of making it together. So there are different aesthetics offered in this chapter, in these volumes. Hong Xin and other Chinese classics that I mentioned. And here from, this is the personal archive of Daniel. The family only took one publishing of Viro.
Only lasted one
throughout history in Brazil. Perhaps there were many. But they only kept this, we only have this third volume of Viro, in which on the left we can see all the productions, like the, not all, but some of the production, the list that they published. So Nyonya Nona, they published Masakan Sehari Hari. And this is very important because Ong King Neo, as the wife of Lee Jong Lim, was also involved in production of comics, particularly this for ladies. So it was kind of gender distributed. She signed it under the name Eleonora, and it's a list of a lot of recipes of Indonesian, Europa, and Tionghoa. So all of them she has listed and give the recipes. Also about fashion and other books. So this is the sehari-hari, masakan sehari-hari, the everyday food. But we also know that maybe Daniel can talk more about the authorship of the grandmother. However, in this project, we haven't focused on bringing to the fore the authorship of female writers or the comic makers, which is almost inexistent, unfortunately. And maybe in another forum, yes, in the 50s, we can address this in another forum. I think, yeah, and I also created this web-based information timeline of the comics and situating the comics of Toko Buku Liong within the time, starting with the 30s until 58, actually 58 before, yeah, when they left. And it is interesting that most of the publishing industry or the main publishing industry of that time in Indonesia was run by Indonesians of Chinese descent and comic productions mainly. So I have listed the name of the comic makers of that time in this text before here, in which you can read further. But yeah, maybe Daniel, you want to add about the grandmother.
Let me just go back to stop sharing. So for me, we also were going back and forth with this information. You know, sometimes we were in doubt of something that we would directly ask one of my aunts. This project is in memoriam. The oldest daughter of them, Mayani, she passed away while we were doing this research in January. So this project is in memoriam towards her, and also in memoriam to all of my ancestors who were possible to make this happen. So again, thinking about how were their life in Brazil, I started to question a lot about the authorship in Toko Buku Liong, because first of all, I'm an artist as well. So there's many things of creative process that I identify. In when I was a teenager, I studied without knowing about Toko Buku Liong. I started to study comic books. So I also understood and started studying how, what's the structure that usually is made to create comic books. And then looking at what they did afterwards and how they were narrated by my family, what they were like, my grandfather, and my grandmother, I start to question a lot. Okay, this business, they were sharing everything. They were 50-50. My grandmother, she was doing the business. She was doing everything. There was no gender role. You do this and I do that. They were doing everything together. And also they were doing together everything in the publishing part. But then I started to think about, okay, if they were doing everything together, then why there are divisions? The first question comes, which is a question for everybody. What are the possibilities of other genders to be authors, you know? If today we're questioned about the possibility of existence of trans people and they're being part of other jobs, in the 50s, the question was related with cisgender women. Was it, I bring this question, was it possible for a cisgender woman to be an author of Adventures comic book? And then I start to think about the roles that how they were told in Brazil. For instance, my grandmother, she was related to someone who was very actively artist. She was good in everything. She was cooking. She was writing books about cooking. She was drawing beautifully. She was playing instruments. She was multi-artist, very skilled. While my grandfather, he was entrepreneur, business person, and later on came back making publishing. And later on, my grandfather published again in Brazil books about cooking. So then I wonder, was actually a switch of roles, first of all? And then because of this wondering, I was able to make the question, was Onkinio actually one of the authors of Wiro? And then the good thing about having a living memory, I was able to ask my grandma, my aunts who were living at the time, they were pre-teenagers, so their memory was very much fresh. And then I made this question, was mommy, that's how we call it, was mommy author as well, widow? And then in this person, yes, I remember she's sitting down and having a meeting with Quicken Ho and Lee Jo Lee and other employees, and they were drawing together and talking about scripts. So we understand Toko Buku Liong as this creative powerhouse who had, and we don't have more than one author actually. So in this process, I understood there were many erasures. One of the erasures through time was erasing Toko Buku Liong, erasing Lee Jo Lee. And then because at that time there was a gender erasure, there was a gender of a female artist. So I see that my grandmother, she went through double erasure. And once also when she migrated to Brazil, all these roles that she has as an autonomous woman, she was taken to become only the provider mother, the roles of a mother. When before she was an entrepreneur, she was a creative, she was actively publishing. So I see the immigration as a very traumatic process. Saying that this is just like a introduction for our final chapter we just released yesterday, which is the last one. Now, if the first one we're talking about the plays, the second we talk about the who were, and the third one we're talking about what they did, the last one we're talking about something very specific that we brought again. That's it.
Just to add on this third volume, from my brief research on the comic productions of the 40s and 50s, what is interesting about Toko Buku Liong is also that they were, I think, one of the only independent producers that, for instance, had a book, a bookstore, and also in the back of the bookstore, they were producing their own comics and books. And if we look at the mainstream history of comics, we only know that there has been Melody in Bandung or Gapura in Jakarta, and or the newspapers as a main outlet of comic distribution. And so as a small independent bookstore, I hope to find out more from other researchers in the comic productions of the time, if there were other bookstore owners and producers or comic makers that were working with bookstores at that time. And we also look forward for the talk with Pa Senogumira Ajidharma, who I invited to join us to share more about Toko Buku Liong's function, about the comics that himself also read and knows some of them, especially Wiro. And in that talk, we hope to explore more this idea, this theme of comic productions in that particular time, how they engaged or contributed in that search for a cultural identity, and also focusing on Wiro, the monumental work, if I may quote, in comic productions in history, in the history of Indonesia. And then, yes, we can go to talk about the fourth.
Let me just do a brief invitation. So I also invite everybody to enter the viewing room of the installation I made, Gown, Reverberação Reverb.
Let's take a look.
Now I think it's better people just access.
Oh.
Don't need too sharp, because otherwise we're going to stand too much. Access and make your parallels regarding this chapter. I'd rather not say too much because it's a visual proposition and installation proposition that is more closely to my artistic practice that I have been doing so far. Now we move to the final chapter, and so I'm going to be opening to questions. So we still, we're sharing now towards the fourth chapter. Mm-hmm. I'm going to close this one. Okay. Specters of Wiro. Oh, should I? Yeah.
We divided this volume into which one is related to my research and the second one to Daniel's perspective on Wiro today, or how Daniel sees the consequences of this comic production. And the first one is compiling images of Wiro for those who haven't read the comic or don't have access to it. It's indeed quite difficult to find this comic in its full 10 volumes. Either it's only in collections in Jakarta. I think Aji Wijaya is one of the most collectors of comics his collection is very wide and comprehensive. And I also been in touch with him and mentioned that he has the first edition of this comic. But these images are taken from the courtesy of Mika Susanto, who has the edition, I think, published in around 60s, if I'm not wrong. So the comic has been published several times, starting with the migration, after the migration of the Lee family. We haven't analyzed or researched the copyrights, for instance, of this comic. We don't know who was given the copyrights of this comic to be reproduced afterwards, but it has been reproduced quite a lot. And also this version. Maybe go back to... And so this part is just addressing some questions that I compiled related to my reading of Viro, but also to the archives that I shared openly for everyone to access, which I think is a very interesting possibility with this online platform. These have been offered with the courtesy of people, the writers, and also by accessing Compass newspaper, for instance, for the Arsuendo Atmovilotto, who unfortunately has already passed away. And others have been given by Senno Gumira himself, who has often written about Viro in several newspapers, among which Tempo and also Compass, but also we have shared with the with his kind gesture to give us a paper about Put On and other comics of Chinese Indonesians in the 50s, which hasn't been yet published. I think Paseno is also planning to release a book about his research on comics that is going to come up soon with a publisher from Jogja. Just to access, for instance, this article has been written in 1980 by the High magazine, the redaction, and it is the only one who mentions that the family has migrated to Brazil. The other articles are only mistaken the name or only mentioning Quicking Who as the author of the comic and the illustrator. And others don't mention Lee John Lim at all. I have to admit, I was surprised to see an exhibition curated by Hikmat Darmawan in Jakarta about the history of comics. And of course, Viro is part of the timeline that he created to make these categories of comics based on Arsuento's previous research and also research that he shared in Compass. And I was surprised to see that Lee John Lim was also not included, although there is research that I open now to show that even in the 80s, but perhaps because of archiving issues of comics and also the accessibility of some of these archives is difficult in Indonesia, then I thought that this is an interesting gesture to share everything here, everything that I found about Viro being mentioned in media. In 2002, Mika Susanto also wrote an article about Viro asking who is the writer of Viro, because he didn't know at that time. And Senno Gumira replied to his article 1 week after in Tempo magazine, talking about this difficulty or the failure of archiving comics in Indonesia. And then later on, we have in 2008, Tempo has published a very interesting edition related to 100 notes or books that have been recorded within the journey of a country, Kebangkitan Nasional, the National Awakening Plan, or this was the edition, special edition, in which Bambang Bujono, a cultural activist and cultural thinker, has placed Viro Anakrimba in the 89 number of the most influential book in this National Awakening program. And we also met in Semarang Pak Zikri, who created an adaptation of Viro called Varo. It was an interesting encounter because Zikri lives in Semarang and has been a very active comic maker for Suara Merdeka, a newspaper in Semarang in the 70s, and later on, I think until 90s when he retired. And Varo was published in three editions, three volumes, by Maranatha, a publisher from Bandung, who was asking Pak Zikri to create a comic that could be so popular as Viro. And so he created the Waro.
What about the one with Obama?
Yeah, we didn't share that. We have also some articles from the online. For instance, there is a novelist, a female novelist, I think, which I found the only female person who has mentioned that Viro was one of the books that she first read and has influenced her career as a writer. And another article mentions that Obama was also reading Viro in his childhood when he lived in Bandung, I think. So this is what we wanted to kind of compile here and archive with this platform, all these materials in the media that have mentioned Viro and its contribution. However, after we have explored the content of Viro, myself together with Daniel, we have kind of understood that this comic has been created in a certain particular context in the 50s, related to this post-colonial condition, and also this, as Pak Seno mentions, as a very Indonesia-centric comic in which Viro explores the archipelago Nusantara, going from an island to an island, from Sumatra to Sulawesi, and also to Irian, to Papua. Of course, there is a problematic here that Pak Seno already touched upon in his short writings, and we hope to explore that more during his talk. But there has been, I think it's also a very Java-centric comic in the sense that Viro sees the people from the outer islands as wild, while himself is the modern person, although he is a jungle boy. But when he returns to his home, which is placed somewhere in central Java, we don't know which city, but he was born in central Java, and when he returns, he embraces this modern life in which he builds a house. He goes with a pedicab, with a becak, and also has this very urban middle class position in
change
which
clothes.
Yeah, he's very into having clothes and all these modern
Western
tools to that he learned from Dr. Watson and Miss Lana. So there is a complex reading that perhaps we won't touch upon much in this talk because I think we have only like around 10 minutes left. But if you want to add something,
yeah, just to
also about your work, we can share.
Yeah, then I'm just going to do the introduction that we go there. Wait. Me, 29 years old, figuring out that my grandparents did this, you know, and that still nowadays people are doing bootleg version. Don't share yet. Wait. People are still doing nowadays bootleg version, still being printed, and then figuring out there were many articles talking about what they did, that even the former president of the United States was reading as a childhood. And then I was like, how the hell? I don't know that what my grandparents did caused this impact in Indonesian culture, you know? So being an artist, it got me emotionally very hard because how come you are an artist and then you erase your biggest graphic creation from your family? And then not even like my aunt and grandfather, they knew the extent of this impact, you know? So how come you erased this? Was the migration so traumatic that you need to forget about everything, you know? How come I figured out this later? And then for me, there was something that I felt later on was quite beautiful. First of all, I thought with the adults' research, it was republished without their consent. You know, at least it was without their consent. Because it was republished, it made sense to the time politically and to the people to consume that type of work and artwork. And then with that, it also I think even my grandparents didn't know that the extent of fame that widow had. So later on, I made peace with all this conflict, which was, they made something which was a legacy. They made something which they didn't need to, they created something that kept going. And this I find quite beautiful because it's an unintentional legacy, but it contributes to culture and impacts in such a big way. And the work by itself, me as an artist, this is something that I dream. So I figured out this when I was already 29 years old. I was already more emotionally, psychologically stable with my own career because otherwise this could have been a big shadow. But also due to my perspective, my politics perspectives, the way I understand ethics, and that I was only getting the second edition of Widow. When I got here in Indonesia in 2019, I was able to see all the images and all the context of Widow, the full 10 volumes. I got shocked because there are many values that I did not agree. And there are many things that I repulse, actually. And of course, I got shocked. Grandparents, you did this, you know. But of course, I also tried to read it in a very complex and a very more broad sense. You know, this was a reflex of the times, actually, as well. Mostly also understanding how much this pop icon culture influenced the creation and the shape of Indonesian identity, this new Indonesian identity. I also thought it was quite ironic that, so you create something that helps shape the subjectivity of children and kids of what is to be Indonesian, but you cannot take part of it because this shaping of Indonesia meant they were being excluded. As Indonesians started to become more and more Indonesian, they start to become more and more foreigners because they were written as Chinese and they could not take part of what culture would be if they were being threatened. So in this sense, I started to think, what if Widow was still alive? What if Widow was a child, the 10th child, because both of them had 9 children. What if Widow was the 10th child and this 10th child decided to stay in Indonesia? What if it kept having a life? What was the values inside of Wiro in 1950s that kept going and became present till nowadays? So in this sense, I also invite you to read the text, and I made a few illustrations of Wiro in 2020. What are the things that he is dealing and the consequences of the things that he's doing? So for instance, we start here with Wiro returns with the jungle, and the friend, the monkey friend that Wiro has is now a skeleton. Or Widow and the Paradox of Time. I'm not going to say much about this. Widow and the Sea of 1,500,000 Souls. So I think from Adele, it's very important the perspective that I respect a lot the process that Indonesia did right after the independence, because me, myself, somebody who strongly fight for decolonization, especially from Brazil perspective. I understand what Indonesia was doing right after the post-colonial. It was illegal process of decolonization to take away privilege from a minority and take it to the majority. But in a sense, the facts that happened after that, together with the whole war with communism and capitalism, the infiltration of CIA, United States, in the government of Indonesia. Then I present this work, Widow and the Sea of 1,500,000 Souls. And just to remind this, after in the 60s, that might have been something that my family escaped. And then later on, I do Widow and the Birth of One Identity, regarding what I said in the past of the paradox of the creator of this novel and how it helped shape the identity. And later not least, Widow and the Consequences of Patriarchy. And Widow as an elder seeing this dragon eating its own tail as the Ouroboros, seeing the vision of the forest he loved so much now in completely fire and being destroyed. So yes, this project is very much just my final regards. This project is very much me trying to understand existence and me having the privilege to have tools to have the existence. I think emotion and archive, everybody has it. It can be only memories and our own memories of what people tell about, like relatives or people who, I also think that ancestors are the people who gave us affection. They don't necessarily need to be biologically related to us. But I have been had the access and the privilege to organize this archive. And this pretty much, this project is an organization of archive and how we've been doing that. And this started since we decided to, okay, let's do a platform. So we presented four volumes and this panel of discussion, but there is one invisible work, which is we, as a group, as a collective, involving Cemeti's team as well, we needed to think, okay, how we're gonna organize this and how we're gonna present this online, since the theme about online publication, online exhibition, it's quite new due to the pandemic's situation.
As a final comment, maybe I would like to just touch upon the fact that this project is also trying to engage with more people who are interested in these topics, and as a way for us to explore it either together or we hope that this can be also a form of reflection or inspiration for other researchers who are looking at this period of time or at these narratives. And also, I think overall, for me, it's another way to counter these nationalistic frameworks of Indonesian art historiography. This is something that I hope this project will do, and I think we can continue with questions from the audience. Zikri, thank you so much for listening until now.
Okay, thank you, Danieli and Adelina Luft. A very comprehensive explanation about the project.